Thank you. approved it. That is supreme authority. Then we can start the class.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
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 Narayanam Namaskritya.
Narayanam Namaskritya.
Naram Chaiva Narottamam.
Naram Chaiva Narottamam.
Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam.
Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam.
Tato Jaya Udiryet.
Tato Jaya Udiryet.
Shrutam Swakatha Krishna.
Shrutam Swakatha Krishna.
Punya Shravana Kirtanah.
Punya Shravana Kirtanah.
Hridayantasto Hyabhadrani.
Hridayantasto Hyabhadrani.
Vidunoti Surasatam.
Vidunoti Surasatam.
Nashta Prayesha Bhadreshu.
Nashta Prayesha Bhadreshu.
Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya.
Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya.
Bhagavate Uttam Shloke.
Bhagavate Uttam Shloke.
Bhaktir Bhakti Naishtiki.
Bhaktir Bhakti Naishtiki.
Hare Krishna. So today we will be covering Srimad Bhagavatam, 7th canto, chapter 7. What Prahlad learned in the home. So what chapter did we cover last week? We covered Srimad Bhagavatam, 7th canto, chapter 6. Prahlad Maharaj preaches to the sons of the demons. And these sons of the demons are his classmates. And at the end of that chapter, there was a question raised. So we'll continue from, after that. So here Srimad Bhagavatam, 7th canto. 7th chapter, verse 1.
Shri Narada Vacha.
Shri Narada Vacha.
Evam Dete Sutra Krishna.
Evam Dete Sutra Krishna.
Mahabhagavato Asuraha.
Mahabhagavato Asuraha.
Vacha Tana Samyamanaha.
Vacha Tana Samyamanaha.
Smarana Madanu Bhashitam.
Smarana Bhashitam.
Shri Narada Vacha. The great saint Narada Muni said, Evam, thus, Dathya Sutahe, by the sons of the demons, Prishtaha, being questioned, Mahabhagavataha, the exalted devotee of the Lord, Asuraha, born in the family of demons, Vacha, spoke, Tan, unto them, the sons of the demons, Smayamana, smiling, Smaran, remembering, Mad Anubhashitam, what was spoken by me. Translation by His Divine Grace, Srila Tridhana Swami, Srila Prabhupada. Narada Muni said, although Prahlad Maharaj was born in a family of asuras, he was the greatest of all devotees. Having thus been questioned by his class friends, the sons of the asuras, he remembered the words spoken to him by me and replied to his friends as follows. When he was in the womb of his mother, Prahlad Maharaj listened to the words of Narada Muni. One cannot imagine how the baby in embryo could hear Narada. But this is spiritual life. Progress in spiritual life cannot be obstructed by any material condition. This is called ahetukya apratihata. Reception of spiritual knowledge is never checked by any material condition. Thus Prahlad Maharaj from his very childhood spoke spiritual knowledge to his class friends. And certainly it was effective. Although all of them were children. Hare Krishna. Om Adhyana Divarandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurve Namaha Mukham Karoti Vachalam Pangum Langayate Girim Yatripataham Mande Shri Gurundinataram Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. So this is a wonderful chapter where, you know, Prahlad Maharaj, he gets the opportunity to preach to his classmates and further after the inquiry. And one of the very important words here is Smayamanaha. Prahlad Maharaj is responding to the inquiry of his classmates. They inquire, they have a doubt that Prahlad, you know, you have only known teach, we have only known teachers Chanda and Amarka, the sons of Shukracharya. And how is it that you are saying that you have learned all this? And where have you learned all this? So they are inquiring. And Prahlad Maharaj is smiling, thinking, remembering the words spoken by who? Narad Muni. And also he is very happy at his heart that this is the opportunity to get these sons of demons. Then, you know, this is the inquisitiveness of those sons of demons. And because they heard in the previous chapter the glories of devotional service and the fruitlessness, you know, the invalidity of this material nature and the grihastha ashram, when you get attracted to wealth and money and become a victim and fall into the dark where andhakupam. So there are six sections this chapter is divided into, so we will be deriving lessons from that. So the first is history of the birth of Prahlad Maharaj. So Devarshi Narad has of course revealed this history. So we'll cover that first. Hare Krishna. So again, what was the inquiry Prahlad made? Means the sons of the Suras made of Prahlad Maharaj?
What did Prahlad learn about the concept of knowledge?
Yes, where he learned. So now, in the purport, Srila Prabhupada says that he learned in the embryo of his mother, means in, as an embryo, in the womb of his mother. Now this is very difficult from, you know, general populace to understand. And why is it so difficult for general populace to understand? Because they are thinking that material condition could limit one's spiritual progress. So in the last class there was also a question raised that sometimes women considered less intelligent. And Prahlad Maharaj, he does refer to it, but there is a context attached to it. So we will be looking at that context as part of our, at the end of this particular first lesson that we learn, history of birth of Prahlad. So it so happened that Hiranyakashipu had departed to Madhurachal mountain. So Prahlad Maharaj is received, you know, identifying to his friends about those incidents, that when our father is referring, because he is also a king, and king is like a father. So he has gone to Mandarachala to perform great austerities. Hiranyakashipu had gone. So when Hiranyakashipu had gone, what happened? In the absence of the king, the neighboring, the opposing parties, they feel like, okay, they can attack, right? And who is the opposing party of Asuras? Suras, the demigods. So demigods headed by Indra, the king Indra, he is the king of the demigods, they attacked the kingdom of Hiranyakashipu. And all the generals, the demon generals, they were getting killed. And seeing this, you know, extraneous effort by the demigods in fighting and killing the demons and the general of the demons, they start fleeing away from the battle. So this also shows that's not the Kshatriya dharma. A Kshatriya would normally stand on the battlefield. However, in this case, they are fleeing and without taking care of their belongings, their wives, their children, the treasury, their house, their neighbors, their relatives, without taking care of any of those, they're just running away. And such is the case that when demons are running away, the demigods, they of course enter into the kingdom of Hiranyakashipu and they plunder the palace. And nothing was remaining, as they were plundering and destroying everything that was in the way. And they got hold of Prahlad's brother. So Prahlad wasn't born, so wife of Hiranyakashipu, so Lord Indra, he held her hand, he was taking her, it is described, just like, and she was crying, just like a Kurai bird is crying once captured by the vulture. So what is Prahlad Maharaj's mother's name?
Kayadu.
Kayadu. Hirenkashipu's wife. And as she was being dragged in this, you know, state, Vimashi Narada appears. And it is very interesting that Prahlad Narada says that he appeared when he had no other engagement. Well, in case of Vaishnavas, they always appear at the, especially Vimashi Narada, he knows how to appear at the right place at the right time for the right purpose. So he appears and we are there, and he immediately checks the advancement of Indradeva. And he says, "Oh King Indra, why are you taking this woman? Because she is certainly sinless and innocent." So at that time, Indradeva says that, "Oh, in the womb of this woman, the wife of Hirenyakashipu, is his seed. So we are taking her, and once the child is born, we will release her." Now what's the intention behind this? They're thinking that there is a big demon in the womb of Hirenyakashipu's wife, and that as soon as the child will be born, they will kill the child and release the wife of Hirenyakashipu. Because this is a normal understanding. You know, even in the materialistic world, sometimes people are illusioned that a demon son will come out to be a demon. But let's look at the history. Hirenyakashipu himself is son of who? Kashyapu Muni, who is a great devotee. So we should not always understand that someone, you know, a son of a demon will be a demon, or a son of a devotee will be a devotee as well. So we have to be very careful when we are making such judgments. And Devashi Narad reveals that in the womb of this woman is a great devotee, a powerful servant of the Supreme Personality of God. And Devashi Narada says this. King Indra immediately releases her, and all the demigods, they circumambulate her. That is, to give respect to the great devotee in her womb and to ask for forgiveness. So this is Vaishnavacharya. Vaishnavacharya here is basically revealed, and Srila Prabhupada in the purport says, it is in the disciplic succession that when a great acharya speaks, you take his words as truth, and all the demigods will accept it. And this is the significance of parampara system, Shabda Pramana. Now this is a good point to understand what is Shabda Pramana. Shabda Pramana is, you know, the words spoken by the great devotees and sadhu, guru and shastra. These are the three references for Shabda Pramana. Now someone can say, okay, if this is the way to attain knowledge and accept what is being said, then what are the other ways? There are two other ways. One is Pratyaksha Pramana, and the second one is Anumana Pramana. Pratyaksha Pramana is something that is visible to your eyes, visible to, you know, your senses. And then Srila Prabhupada reveals that coming from the scriptures, our senses are imperfect, right? When we are standing in dark, we can't even see our hands and legs. So we need light to be able to see things. And again, we are all aware that even with our senses, sometimes we get deluded. Illusion happens. Because, like in mirage, the mirage appears in the desert. Why? Because of the variation of heat near the sand. And it appears that at a distance there is water, where there is none. And Brahma Maharaj also says that similarly, where is water in the desert? There is no water in the desert, it's just a mirage. So similarly, there is happiness in this material world. It's revealing that when we are materially attached, no matter how much effort we make, we will never attain the happiness that we see. So Pratyaksha Pramana is not really the right way, it's understood. Then we can come to Anumana Pramana. As Srila Prabhupada has revealed, that Anumana Pramana is speculation. It is hypothesis. He says, she says scenario. Where if somebody says something, well, that's their opinion, it's not a truth. So we cannot accept Anumana Pramana to be the valid way of accepting knowledge. So now how do you accept knowledge? You accept knowledge through Shabda Pramana, coming from Guru, Sadhu and Shastra. Guru is the spiritual master, sadhu is the saintly persons who are Vaishnavas, and then Shastra are the revealed scriptures like Srimad Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita, Chaitanya Charitamrita, and so many other scriptures provided to us by acharyas. So it's very interesting that in the material world this happens. And here, accepting Narada Muni's words, all the demigods, they, after Sankaran Mriti, they leave Kayadu. Now, Devishnara, understanding the state of Kayadu, the wife of Hiranyakashipu, he takes her to his ashram. Now here, Narada Muni, he is a young man. Kayadu, she is a young woman. So Srila Prabhupada, the purpose reveals and warns us that looking at that example, we should not try to imitate. And from his own examples, he used to make sure that, you know, the students, his disciples, will learn that one should not be in company even of his mother or sister in an isolated place, in a kant, in a secluded place. So it is very important to learn from this. However, it does not hold for Narada Muni because he is a pure devotee of the Lord. It's very interesting that in the purport, Srila Prabhupada also gives example of Haridas Thakur. It just so happened that Haridas Thakur, his glories were increasing in Mayapur. At that time at Dalvi, there was a Jamindar, a landlord, who became very envious of him. He said, oh, he is such a big devotee, okay, let me show everyone how big he is. So he sends a prostitute to go and visit Haridas Thakur. And this prostitute comes to Haridas Thakur's kutir after the dawn, you know, like the, after the dusk time, as it's getting dark. And Haridas Thakur, he's chanting his rounds. So how many rounds did Haridas Thakur used to chant? 300 rounds every day. So as Haridas Thakur was chanting and he saw this beautiful young woman coming to him, he understood what her purpose was. But he said, just give me a little while, let me finish my chanting. And then I will come and give you the company that you see. And she just waited, she understood, okay, that he will just finish his chanting and then he will come. And she thought, how long can he chant? Haridas Thakur, however, was continuing to chant throughout the night. And then he said, oh, it's morning, not appropriate time, so come tomorrow. And she comes the next day. And what happens next day? Same thing. He's chanting. And then he continues to chant, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So his chanting is continuing. And second night also passes similarly. Third night also she comes. And all night he's chanting. And after the third night finishes, it passes. Even she has become a devotee of the Lord. Looking at the purity of Haridas Thakur, looking and hearing to the chanting, Krishna is all attracted. So of course, she gets attracted by the chanting of Haridas Thakur and listening to the Mahamantra. She is doing Shavaram, it's Adhyasukruti. And just by that process, just by taking to that process sincerely, she becomes a devotee. So here Kayadu, what is her purpose? She is basically looking for protection for, you know, the child in her womb. Radha Maharaj is in her womb. So she wanted to protect her womb first. And then second was, she was anxiously waiting for the return of her husband. Now this is the context in this particular case where Devashi Narad took her to his ashram, where she sincerely served him with devotion. So now she is engaged in devotion service, again in the serving of Vaishnava. So as she is serving Vaishnava, of course there is potency. And Devashi Narad tells her, oh my child, do not fear from any direction. And you can stay here till the child is born and when your husband returns. So now, as she is serving Devashi Narad every day, she is very anxious at heart. And when someone is very anxious, very much disturbed, you know, fearing that there could be an attack on her home, on her child, as well as where is her husband, she is always seeking, okay, maybe today my husband will return, and she is constantly thinking about her husband. Devashi Narad, he is being very merciful, he is imparting the spiritual knowledge on the transcendental subject. The knowledge that is free of all material contamination. So such knowledge has been imparted to her, but because of her anxiety, she is not able to remember. And Prahlad Maharaj reveals that being unintelligent means being less intelligent, actually, being a woman, and less intelligent because of that situation. She has forgotten because of the long time that has passed since those instructions were imparted to her and to the present moment. While he did not forget, and he also reveals why he did not forget, because he was blessed by his spiritual master Devarshi Narad. So again, it is very important when one takes to devotional service, one has to take to, what does one have to do? Yes, one has to first accept a spiritual master, surrender to the lotus feet of spiritual master, serve them, and then inquire from them submissively with that attitude. So here, Prahlad Maharaj, he remembers because he was blessed by his spiritual master. And similarly, Prahlad Maharaj says to his friends, "Oh my dear friends, the sons of Asuras, you all can also attain this knowledge even though you have small children." And in the purport that we read today, Srila Prabhupada reveals that the material condition cannot restrict one's spiritual progress. And later also we'll see similar aspects being covered. Now this is the point where Prahlad Maharaj of course continued to preach because he had already answered the question. Yet at the same time he saw the curiosity in the eyes of his friends. He saw how anxiously they were, waiting and, inquiring from him, like, okay, how did you learn this knowledge? So of course the next topic of Vaishnava does, and of course Prahlad Maharaj, who is a Mahajana, he seeks this opportunity to preach to them what he had learned, the transcendental knowledge. So he of course revealed that it is free of all material contamination. And then comes to the second chapter, the second lesson in this particular chapter, where the teachings of Narad Muni that he had learned in the womb of his mother, hearing to the instructions of Devarshi Narad. Prahlad Maharaj here reveals the difference between body and soul. And he gives a very nice analogy. He reveals that just like a fruit to a tree, so a fruit that is born from a tree basically goes through the six stages and basically that perishes over time. So the six different states, something that's born is birth, existence, maintenance, growth, dwindling, and death or destruction or annihilation, as you can see. So those are the six conditions the body goes through. It takes birth, just like a child is born. So the body of a child is born. It exists for some time. It grows, it continues to transform over the period. From childhood to boyhood to youth to old age. And then as it's getting transformed after maintenance and so forth, it starts to dwindle. The old age comes, and after dwindling comes death, which is annihilation of the body. So he's saying that this is the state of the body, just like a fruit goes to a similar state, and compared to the fruit, the tree has a longer life. So analogies have some limitations. So here, even though a tree also goes through this transformation, but he's trying to impart that knowledge that soul is eternal. Soul is eternal and is unchanging. And Srila Prabhupada in the purport, he reveals that a soul is unchanging because, and also that it is uncovered and it does not mix with the body. So when Prahlad Maharaj reveals that it does not mix with the body, he is basically referring to the various elements of the body. And this is the place where Prahlad Maharaj starts hearing them that there are 16 elements, the 11 sensory elements. He is revealing to the sense objects as well as the senses. And then the three modes of material nature, those are being revealed. And what are the three modes of material nature? Mode of goodness, Satvaguna, mode of passion, Rajaguna, and mode of ignorance is Tamaguna. So those three modes, you know, they influence us and they influence the material body. And as he's revealing, he says there are actually two types of bodies. And of course, in Bhagavad Gita, it is revealed that in material nature there are 24 elements. He reveals that. And then Srila Prabhupada further elaborates in his purport that of these 24 elements, you know, all these are material. The bodies are of two types. The first is gross body, made of five gross elements. Shishi Kalantai Ki Jai. Shishi Radhamadan Mohan Ki Jai. Shishi Sita Ram Rashma Harman Ki Jai. Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Narmanji Kodi Vaishnava Vrinda Ki Jai. So the first is the gross body made of five gross elements, earth, water, fire, air, ether. And then the second body is a subtle body made of three subtle elements, intelligence, mind and false ego. While beyond these 24, means these two types of bodies, there are two. And the word referred to is Atma. Atma and Paramatma. So again, Atma refers to soul. And of course, from Ataram Goswami, we also understand that Atma can also mean soul and super soul. So there is soul in the body, and also there is super soul in the body. Super soul is Paramatma. Sometimes also Srila Prabhupada warns that sometimes some teachers they mislead, and especially in Mayavadi Sampradaya, this happens a lot. Mayavada, it is said, Mimamsa theory, where it is said, okay, super soul is in the body, that means we are all super soul. We are all eternal, we have a similar characteristic, while that ekatvam, you know, we are all God has been completely, rejected. Yes, rejected. In Vaishnava philosophy, because as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu identifies the ekatvam principle in the previous chapter also, Prahlad Maharaj, he explains that this oneness is different way. And it's achintya veda veda tattva. So the relationship between the soul and the super soul is simultaneous, one and different. Tattva means in truth. So the very essence. It has been explained in two different ways. First is that this particular tattva, how is it different? First of all, we are same in quality as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Krishna. Right? However, we are limited in quantity. So same in quantity but different in quantity. And what are some of the metaphors given? Gold mine. So there is an example given that there is a ring made of gold, right? It's coming from the gold mine. But does that ring, is it the gold mine? No, it's not. Right? The ring has the same quality. The gold element is same. However, the quantity, it differs. Because in gold mine, there is huge amount. While in a ring, it's limited. So, similarly, Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Krishna is unlimited. While we are limited, even though of the same quality. Now there is a context-driven similarity and difference as well. That is, referring to our dharma. Every living entity is an eternal servant of the Lord. It is also revealed in Chaitanya Chaitanya. Jivena Swarup Haya Krishnera Nitya Das. Jivena Swarup, you know, the eternal position of a constitutional position of a living entity, a soul, is Krishnera Nitya Das, an eternal servant of Lord Krishna. Krishnera Tatastha Shakti. A living entity is a marginal potency, marginal energy of Lord Krishna's. So there are three energies. So this living entity is a marginal one. Ved Abhed Prakash. You know, that is simultaneously one and different. Ved is difference, a various non-different. So simultaneously. So when a living entity is engaged in devotional service with love, with faith, with enthusiasm, with determination and patience, just trying to please the Supreme Personality of Godhead, at that time, the two contexts, you know, a servant is serving the master and master is accepting the service of the servant, they are one and one different because the context is same, to please each other. Because just by serving and pleasing the Lord, one gets pleased. Right? Our hearts are fully satisfied and we feel unlimited jubilation, transcendental jubilation. So that is the case being revealed. So as Prahlad Maharaj continues to identify the difference between body and material, giving the example of a fruit of a tree versus the tree. He continues. So again, it is very interesting that he realizes he is giving this transcendental knowledge and who is he giving it to?
His classmates,
persons of demons, who are learning how to be politically strong and how to identify their enemies and friends. And he wants to give them the concept of Samadarshana. But to give that final lesson of Samadarshana, he has to go step by step. He says, okay, but if you don't understand this, and if you engage your body in various activities, right, then it's fruitless. Because why do people perform activities? Why don't they engage in NGO? Materialist, basically, we are talking about. Because in the material world, everyone wants to become happy. And to become happy, they take on different endeavors. But by taking on to those endeavors, what happens? They lose the precious time and energy. Right? It takes a lot of effort to do. And effort to do those efforts, it takes time. And as they engage on all this time and energy, at the end, what they get is distress. They do not get happiness. And when you do not get happiness, what happens? You have put so much time and energy. Kamesha, Krodesha, Rajaguna, Samudhubha. Mahashana, Mahapapa, with the Enam, you have added. So Lord Krishna in Bhagavad Gita, he reveals that Kamesha, Krodesha. So because of that lust to seek comfort for life, to seek comfort for your body, to seek sense gratification, when you do not get the result that you are looking for, that happiness you are looking for, growth and you know develops anger, and they arise from rajaguna, the mode of passion, and actually they drag us down to the mode of ignorance. So materialist becomes very disturbed when he tries to seek happiness, puts a lot of endeavor to get that happiness and does not get that happiness. And sometimes when you say this to materialists who are very wealthy, you know, they may not be so well satisfied. So at that time, Prahlad Maharaj gets to the next step. But what is the importance of this body, which is temporary? We are trying to satisfy a temporary body, right? And this body, it embraces this soul, which is us, right? And Srila Prabhupada says in the purport, everyone says my hand, my leg. Nobody says I hand, I leg. Because they are not us. They are actually ours. They have been given to us in this human life. Continuing further, he says that all these things are temporary and the body that embraces the soul and then just leaves it to suffer at the end. And similarly is the case of all the paraphernalia that accompanies the body. What is the use of these wives, children, wife or girlfriend? So again, he is also referring to unmarried guys. You know, if you are thinking of girlfriends who give you happiness, then what happens is, you should also understand that there is a temporariness, you know, there is a temporary aspect to this. Everything that starts has an end in this particular case, like activities. So the material activities, they have an end. And the children, you know, the treasury, the vehicles and so forth, the relatives, kutumba, the friends, all of them are temporary in nature. So he is, you know, some of them are inquisitive, so he is provoking that inquisitiveness. To kind of try to understand the difference between eternal and temporary. To try to understand what is true happiness, what is temporary happiness. And try to understand what is lamentation and what is bliss. what is anchoring and what is transcendental jubilation. He is trying to reveal to them that give up this attachment to temporary things and take to permanent things. Now when you tell someone about transcendental happiness, of course, Prahlad Maharaj is identifying. And at the same time, it comes to our, the activities. He says devotional service, take to devotional service, which is very easy and sublime. And this is our chapter, lesson 4, where he is identifying the glories of devotional service. First he is saying, taking to devotional service is first of all very easy. And he had already given to them a reference that in my mother's womb, I could take to devotional service, shavana, right hearing to the instructions, and constantly remember the Supreme Lord. He already referred to the Super Soul. That Supreme Lord is present in everyone's heart, the Super Soul. So you should worship Super Soul, always remembering. You should give respect to all the other living entities as well, knowing that Super Soul is residing in their heart. And he starts revealing, that there are 6 enemies. Kaam, Krodh, Lobh, Moh, Mad, Matsara. We already covered the first two. Lust, Kaam. Krodh is anger. Lobh is greed. Moh, Mad. Then comes madness. Moh is greed and then Mad, Matsara. Kaam, Krodh, Lobh is greed. Moh is attachment to our delusion, right? Mad is madness. And then Matsara is jealousy or envy. So these are the 6 enemies. These are truly the 6 enemies that we have. And of course, previously he had told his father and his friends also that our senses are also our enemies when they are uncontrolled. But then when the same senses are controlled, they become our friends. Which again, your mind is the biggest enemy when it's attached to the material world. But if you can detach it from the material world and attach it to the lotus feet of Krishna, it becomes your best friend. Then at the same time, these 6 have been identified to be enemies here. Because if they are used to attain material gratification, the sense gratification in this material world. So such is the case. And one who has accepted a spiritual master and has won over these 6 enemies is called Swami. Goswami. When we hear the title Goswami, Go means the senses, and Swami is the one who is master of the senses. So one who has been over these 6 enemies and has controlled his senses, he is referred to as Swami or Goswami. While one who continues to be attached to them and continues to be in seeking sense gratification is actually a slave of the senses, right? Go Das. Go in senses, Das. So it becomes Godas. He is the servant of the senses. And at the end, he is constantly lamenting and anchoring. Lamenting is referred to the past, anchoring is referred to the future. And it's very interesting that he is also identifying, he had identified in the previous chapter earlier to his friend, that you should even give up the company of non-devotees. And who is he preaching to? He is preaching to the sons of Asuras, his classmates. Because he realizes that these are innocents. So devotees, they take little risk to approach the innocents. They avoid the envious, yes. Yet at the same time, they approach the innocents to give them their spiritual knowledge. And similarly, Prahlad Maharaj is talking to his friends. And then, now somebody can say, why should I take to this process, right? So Prahlad Maharaj brings them to the most important subject, which is highly elevated. He is basically identifying the difference between material and spiritual. He is saying here at the same time, what is the goal of life? We covered in the last class. The goal of life is take to devotional service. The process is the goal. Now this is the beauty. The process is so simple. It is said. It is so sublime, so transcendental. It doesn't have any tinge of the most material nature when you take to devotional service. Yet at the same time, it is the goal of life to constantly engage in the loving service of Lord Shri Krishna with faith, determination, patience and love. And give up all this temporariness, seeking, what is temporariness? Seeking sense gratification. Seeking to just gratify your senses, seeking material happiness, to give that up. And it's very interesting why it is said to avoid the envious. Srila Prabhupada used to give, you know, he used to share many short stories. And once, he gives a short story which, where he says, in this story, there is a vaidya, a doctor, he visits a household where the landlady, you know, she was sick and having fever, as well as the maid servant, she also was sick. So he looks at both of them, and then when asked, you know, what's their state, he says, well, landlady, her case is simple. You know, she doesn't have much of fever, she's almost normal. But in the case of the servant, it is serious. She has like, you know, 99 or 100 degree Fahrenheit. She really has temperature and she needs treatment. So hearing this, the landlady, she becomes upset. She says, how could my maid servant, you know, she has so much fever. I should have 110 degrees. Srila Prabhupada reveals that at 107 degrees, the body temperature rises such a level that is called a jura, right? You know, that after that just death happens. So this is the case with the materialists, that they are trying to increase the temperature of their body by doing this endeavor, by bringing out all the stress and constantly engaging in such endeavors, engaging in such efforts which are fruitless, which are only going to increase the temperature of the body and cause destruction at the end. While a devotee, you know, he just continues to serve the Lord and not seeking to increase the temperature, increase the stress in life, but rather to please the services. And also at the same time, Chanakya Muni, Srila Prabhupada used to give many examples from, you know, Chanakya Muni's, Chanakya Pandit saints. Chanakya Pandit says, Aranya Akhyavat. Aranya, Grin is debt. Aranya means one who does not have any debt. Akhyavat is one who doesn't have to travel long distance. So he also warns that materialists, they travel long distance daily for their jobs. Even to have fun, they travel long distances. Right? Such is the case. While this is only going to increase their fever and cause hankering and lamentation, continue to increase that fever and cause their destruction. Now somebody can say, wait a minute, devotees, they also travel long distances, but their purpose is different. They are empowered beings by the Supreme Personality of Godhead who are traveling long distance to give this transcendental knowledge to others. Right? So they are already satisfied at heart. They are already Atma Namascha Manya Nirvantara. So again, they are already on the path of self-realization and they are already self-satisfied souls. And why are they going out? To actually remove the hankering and lamentation of other living entities and to give them the transcendental knowledge so that those living entities can also experience the bliss and joy coming from them. It is not they are going out to get something for themselves. They are going out to give something to others. So there is a big context difference. So there is no hankering or lamentation in case of devotees. There is only jubilation and transcendental bliss. So any person, so again, the glory from devotional service is identified and it's open to all. It is not limited by any material in our condition. And Srila Prabhupada reveals that any woman, not just man, but any woman who takes seriously to devotional service, can attain perfection and go back home, back to Godhead. So any person engaged in the service of the Lord, through the instructions of a bona fide spiritual master, is immediately liberated, right? Swami, becomes Swami, because he is engaging his senses in the right purpose, for the purpose they were given to him. And the duty of everyone is to take shelter of the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Shri Shri Radha Madhavan, Shri Shri Sitaram Lakshman, Shri Shri Gauranga. And regardless of the material condition one has, one can achieve to the transcendental platform. Devotional service is not dependent on any of the material qualities. It's not dependent whether one is a brahmana or whether one is austere, whether one is performing heavy level of penances. Prahlad Maharaj reveals this. He says, even taking vows, you know, does not guarantee it. It is to take to devotional service you can attain the transcendental platform. And even without such assets, even a non-devotee or even a woman or a bird or an animal, any living entity, it's open to all, samadarshana, that is the concept has been given. That, you know, vidya vinaya sampanne brahmane kavi hastini shuni chava shvapake cha samadarshana. So again, here he is saying that this devotional service, take to this devotional service, it is so easy, so sublime, gives you transcendental bliss and it is open to all. So anyone can take to this devotional service. And why is Prahlad Maharaj saying this? Because he is making sure that his friends understand that not just in the womb that he was able to get this knowledge, that his friends, when they listen with faith and devotion, they can also take to devotional service. It is so easy. And worship the Lord. So he is saying, the Lord is present in every living entity's heart as super soul. And so, hear about him, glorify him, always remember him and worship him. And worship him is, look at every living entity as a devotee of the Lord. And treat them with respect. So such are the cases. And here, with this, the chapter ends. And of course, what happens at the end of this chapter? Chanda and Amarka, they realize that all the other demons, sons of demons, they are also becoming great devotees of the Lord. And they are both Hiranyakashipu. And that's where the next chapter will start. Hare Krishna. Any questions or any comments at this point? Tantra Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Ananta Kali Vaishnavanam ki jai. All glorious to some of you, Hare Krishna, all glorious to some of you, Hare Krishna, all glorious to some of you, Hare Krishna.